John Reginald Halliday Christie. He was born in 1898 in Yorkshire. His father was a Halifax carpet designer. The family home on the edge of the moors was called Black Boy House. Reggie was the fifth of six children and the second boy. His elder brother Percy was a less dominant influence in his life than his older sisters Florence, Effie and Winnie. Reggie's unused forenames recognised his father's middle name, Ernest John Christie, and his mother's maiden name. Beauty Halliday was the daughter of Halifax's leading bootmaker. This was a solid late Victorian middle-class family, and Ernest John Christie had all the solid Victorian petty bourgeois virtues, and in solid Victorian petty bourgeois way exaggerated them into vices. He was respectable and presentable. He was thrifty and hard-working. He was Spartan and self-denying. He was honest and reliable. He was self-disciplined and untiring. And he expected his little tribe to be unquestioning little reflections of himself. He lacked warmth, humour, tolerance, compassion. If he took his children walking across the moors, he expected them to keep up with him, back straight, steps unflagging, no matter how tired they were. He tolerated no answering back. At times his children could only speak to him through their mother. He believed in thrashings for petty offences. Reggie remembered for life, with justified resentment, a beating his father gave him for supposedly stealing a tomato. Reggie didn't even like tomatoes. Mrs. Christie offered no proper compensation for this horrible upbringing. Though Reggie was her favourite child and she wanted to protect him, she dared not stand up to Ernest openly. She hid Reggie behind her skirts, teaching him dependence, evasion and hypocrisy. In a favourite Victorian term, the lad was not manly. Ernest Christie despised him for it. Beauty Halliday Christie didn't care. He was a little darling. His peer group could be relied upon to spot the weakness and isolate him, which indeed happened. He was a bit of a loner at school, odd and not particularly popular. He was good with figures from the first, and at Halifax Secondary School, where he won a scholarship, notably good at maths and algebra. He felt most secure in group activities, especially those where a uniform made him visibly a normal member of the gang. He sang in All Souls Church Choir. He was a keen Boy Scout. He liked wearing his scout uniform, even when he wasn't actually involved in troop activities. And unlike most boys who go through the scouting phase and proceed to other interests, Christie hung on to become an assistant scoutmaster. His father drew a good deal of public esteem from membership of approved organisations. He was an early member of Halifax Conservative Association and an official of the Primrose League. This, by the way, was not, as one recent publication eccentrically suggested, an organisation to encourage sexual purity among the lower orders. It was a rather romantic forerunner of the Young Conservatives, based on the supposition that Disraeli's favourite flower was the primrose. Ernest Christie was notably prudish and puritanical, refusing to let his family talk about sexual matters. But he was not obsessed with it to the extent of making prudery part of his public life. As chief casualty officer in the carpet factory, Ernest became superintendent of the Halifax St. John's Ambulance Brigade. He supported the Scouts and the Boys' Brigade. He was a keen gardener. And his only eccentric interest, he took up Esperanto. All his life, Reg mimicked aspects of his father's public persona. He, too, retained the connection with the St. John's Ambulance Brigade, displaying framed certificates on his sitting room wall in Rillington Place. He, too, practiced the great English hobby of gardening. And outwardly, Reg echoed some of his father's opinions. He, too, was prudish, objecting vocally to forward young women who exhibited their willingness to attract men, averring that masturbation was disgusting, evincing that suspicion of public houses by which the lower middle classes avoided the trap of drunkenness. But Reg, alas, was unlike his father in that his publicly paraded respectability was fraudulent. In adult life, he hung around the lowest and loosest women. The semen stains of masturbation were found over his clothes and even his plimsolls after his arrest. He lurked in dismal pubs. In adolescence, the mixture of outward puritanism and inward desire created turmoil. Reggie felt overawed by his sisters, who, he claimed, were always bossing him about. Yet when he and his younger sister went to stay with an older married sister, and he saw her leg as she lifted her skirt to fasten a boot, she chided him for blushing about it. What was the poor lad to think was right or wrong in relation to desirable, domineering girls? His first adolescent escapade was a fiasco. Coming away from church one night, he went down a local lover's lane known as the Monkey Run with an experienced girl of his own age. She encouraged him to try some hanky-panky, and poor Christy found himself impotent. The girl told her friends. They told their friends. And the awkward 16-year-old found himself jeered at by kids who already thought him sissy and odd. "Can't do it, Christy," and "Reggie, no, Dick," were humiliating taunts to hear thrown at him in the street. Especially as he had previously boasted about his success with girls, a curious habit that was to stay with him to the end of a life in which he would become infamous as maybe the very worst lover of his generation. On leaving school, he became an assistant cinema projectionist. Before long, the Great War broke out, and as soon as he was 18, Reg joined the army. Uniform and the army suited Reg Christie. Throughout his longish period of training, he made an excellent impression. He was fresh-faced and good-natured. He never lost his temper. He accepted the chaffing that followed his walking his landlady's baby in a pram when he was sent out to billets. On special signals training, his notebooks were kept with such exemplary neatness that the staff asked to retain them as a model for other classes. Soldier Christie made friends who remembered him warmly right up to the time of his public infamy. It may be significant that they knew him as John and not Reg. For the only time in his life, he was attempting to carve a persona different from the one imposed on him by his abusive upbringing. But this, unfortunately, he could not really do. There was no one to tell him that he was allowed to hate his parents for what they had done to him, ought to experience rage if he was to grow beyond its warping and imprisoning control. He was not smiling and good-natured because he felt no hatred of others, but because he dared not express the anger suppressed inside himself. It could only escape occasionally, in moments of catty spitefulness about attractive girls who got into trouble, satisfying Reg by their public humiliation. He was not neat and tidy because he had a well-ordered mind and a natural love of cleanliness, but because he feared losing the esteem and liking of his comrades if they caught a glimpse of his inner chaos and confusion. He had long been obsessively clean externally, washing his hands repeatedly and unnecessarily, a typical hysterics reaction to the deep-seated fear that he was really unclean inside. He would always present a tidy, well-groomed appearance to the world, and boast that he liked to keep his underwear spotless. But this excessive fastidiousness, retained to the end of his life, was still a preposterous veneer on the man when Mr. Hookway observed his home to be a real devil's kitchen, when Mr. McNeil saw it to be filthy and learned it was full of bed-bugs, when the police discovered that his spotless linen was covered with masturbation stains. While stationed at Redmires in Yorkshire, the young soldier started courting a local girl. One of his comrades later asserted that she was Ethel Waddington, who would become his wife after the war. And in 1918, after a long period of training in England, Christie was drafted out to the front. Almost immediately, he was injured by mustard gas in the trenches and suffered a form of shell shock which kept him from seeing any more active service. The gas attacks the eyes and throat, and Christie wrongly believed he had been blinded for some time. He certainly did lose his voice almost completely for about 7 weeks, and had sufficient difficulty in speaking thereafter that he drew a disability pension for the next 3.5 years. Although he was past fit for active service, his voice disappeared again when transfer to the trenches was imminent, and for the rest of his life it was hard for him to speak forcefully, and he would drop to a timid whisper under stress. It is easy to sneer at this obvious hysterical abreaction and suggest that it was a coward's way of avoiding danger. We should not do so. The Great War should have taught us compassion for men whose minds instinctively force their bodies into physical or mental states leading to enforced withdrawal from intolerable conditions. But there is a dreadful symbolic truth about Reg Christie's insinuating, whispering voice. For his was a personality that indeed covered up, repressed, and held back inner truths he dared not enunciate to the world. First, his justified rage about an upbringing that the public would blandly have called sensible training for responsible citizenship. Later, the shady life he led because he dared not openly admit to sexual drives at variance with his father's Puritanism. Finally, the dreadful revenge he took on innocent women to whom he transferred the blame for his own hypocrisy and lust. On his discharge from the army, he returned to work at the cinema. Then, through his father's influence, he was given a clerical job at a worsted mill. He was 22 when he married Ethel Waddington, a quiet, unambitious, and undemanding local girl whose family had long known the Christies. She retained close ties with her brother and sister in Sheffield long after Reg had ceased to have anything to do with his own family. For a few months, Christie seemed on course for the blameless lower-middle-class existence his background made predictable. He had a decent job, well within his capacities. He had a pleasant-looking wife who didn't boss him around. He had his own marital home away from his family. And his nervous, whispery voice had the excellent explanation that he was an old soldier drawing a small disability pension for the injury mustard gas had caused his throat. There was a secret fly in the ointment, however. His marital sex life was unsatisfactory. Like many another conscripted at 18, Reg had found his initial sexual experience with prostitutes. Like many another man brought up under Victorian middle-class mores and married to a woman from a similar background, he found sex difficult with a partner who needed to be coaxed or who had real demands and needs of her own. At first, he was completely impotent in the marriage bed. Later, he could perform with Ethel, but only with some difficulty. He continued to seek release with easily available prostitutes. And he changed his job. Something, possibly the lure of another uniform, persuaded him to become a postman. And he plunged into unmitigated disaster. He pilfered postal orders. He was caught, charged with theft, and imprisoned for 3 months. The trauma, both for him and for a family which prided itself on public respectability, was enormous. When he came out of prison, his disability pension was terminated by a medical board which decided his voice had returned and he was cured. Yet the following year it vanished again for 6 months, probably because his marriage was rocking. And he became quite openly the black sheep of the Christies. It was known in Halifax that he was a client of local prostitutes. The habits of dishonesty remained with him, and he was bound over for obtaining money by fraud and violence. The Christies disowned him and had nothing more to do with him. Ethel shared their repugnance for her disreputable husband. In 1924 she went to live with her relatives in Sheffield, and Reg went down to London to make a fresh start in life. There he was knocked down by a car and spent some time in hospital. Soon after that, he was in trouble with the law again and served 2 short sentences for theft. It is probable, but not certain, that he worked for a time as a haulage clerk. In 1929, he was unemployed and living with a prostitute in Battersea. Living off her, too, for she berated him for having no work, whereupon Reg picked up her son's cricket bat and bashed her over the head. The magistrate, sentencing him to 6 months' hard labour, called it a murderous assault. Christie's improbable defence was that he'd been making a few practice shots and struck the lady by accident. 4 years later, a Catholic priest took pity on this wretched failure and extended the hand of friendship. Christie repaid the good father's kindness by stealing his car, for which he went back to prison. But this time he really seemed to pull himself together. He wrote to Ethel, who came down to see him in Brixton. And in the unlikely setting of the prison visiting room, they settled their differences and agreed that they would have another go at living together on Reggie's release. Ethel gave up her typist's job in Sheffield and joined her husband in London. He found work as a ledger clerk and put petty fraud and larceny behind him. In 1938, the Christies moved into the ground floor flat at 10 Rillington Place. They never became friendly with old Mr. Kitchener in the flat above. He, a staunch conservative, was later to remark that he didn't like Christie or Evans, as one was a socialist and the other a communist. Surely this was a gross libel on the son of Halifax's prominent Primrose League official. But with others in the neighbourhood, Christie established quite a high reputation. He was reasonably well educated, a middle-class man wearing striped suits and collars and ties to work. He was soft-spoken and well-mannered. He claimed a fund of information on a number of topics, especially medical knowledge gleaned from his first aid courses. Though some people found him repulsive and creepy, many others thought him a real gent or a fascinating bloke who knew a lot. Ethel seems to have made a generally good impression until the last years of her life, when her latent racism came out. As war clouds menaced Europe, the Metropolitan Police took precautionary measures against many of their number being drafted. They started a recruiting campaign for extra reserve special constables. And astoundingly, Reg Christie, with a string of convictions as long as his arm, applied. Equally amazingly, the authorities simply accepted his signed assurance that he was a man of good character with no criminal record, and the former petty thief and embezzler affirmed that he would keep the peace and uphold the law in the office of constable on His Majesty's behalf, and spent the first 4 years of the war as a policeman based at Harrow Road Station. It suited him down to the ground. Now he became his father's son in truth, petty, authoritarian and dictatorial. He was photographed several times in his uniform, and one of these pictures stood proudly in a frame on his mantelpiece. He was licensed to indulge his increasing nosiness about other people's business. He and a fellow special became known in the district as the Rat and the Weasel. Some people called Christie the Persecuting Counsel. He was in his element, going on duty into the run-down cafes and pubs of North Kensington, hunting for petty criminals, and throwing his weight around among the prostitutes and drifters of the murky underworld. He could go to these places openly in his uniform, and it was much pleasanter than going there furtively, a sly punter in a shabby raincoat, as he had done throughout his renewed marital life. He enjoyed policing so much that when on holiday with Ethel's relatives in Sheffield, he volunteered his services at the local station and enthusiastically helped in emergency police work after a bombing raid. In 1943, he suffered further humiliation, however. A soldier on active service came home on leave and found Christie involved in a liaison with his wife. The soldier beat Christie up and threw him out of his house. The scandal became known. Shortly after this, Christie was looking for a known thief in a snack bar when he met a tall, dark, attractive Austrian girl named Ruth Furst. Christie cultivated the acquaintance and started taking her home to Rillington Place while Ethel was away at her job in Osram's light bulb factory. Toward the end of 1943, he took Ruth home while Ethel was away on holiday with her Sheffield relatives. Ruth was never to leave. Soon after that, Christie resigned from the police. He handed in his own resignation, but it is likely that he was encouraged to do so following the scandal of the soldier's wife. It was no secret. The soldier sued successfully for divorce, naming Christie as co-respondent. In 1944, Christie started work in the dispatch department of the Ultra Radio Works in Acton. I received a telephone call on a radio phone-in programme recently from a listener who had known him there. She didn't like him at all, and still vividly remembered a works dance that he helped to organise. In the course of the evening he danced with her, and she loathed his furtive attempts to grope her on the dance floor. But another co-worker, Miss Muriel Eady, found Christie good company. She was a 31-year-old spinster who lived with her aunt and had a steady boyfriend. She introduced him to Christie, and the pair of them had tea with Reg and Ethel at Rillington Place on occasion. Once they went to the pictures together as a foursome. Miss Edie suffered from chronic catarrh. Reg always plumed himself on the medical knowledge attested by his St. John's Ambulance Brigade certificates, and he assured her that he had a good cure for that, a special inhalant. Once, while Ethel was away, Miss Edie came to Rillington Place to try Reg's medicine. She never left. After the war, Reg left Ultra and went to work as a clerk in the Post Office Savings Bank. He shouldn't have done so with his criminal record, but given his 4 years police service, nobody suspected this, and he entered the service of the Crown for the fourth time in his life. And so he lived quietly in Rillington Place until the Evanses came there in 1947. His public life was conventional, respectable, narrow, rigid, and boring. His overt hobbies were gardening and photography. His private life was sleazy. He hung round the haunts of Notting Hill prostitutes. His private hobby was still the purchase of their favours. He bored a spy hole above his kitchen door so that he could watch anybody going in and out if they didn't actually need him to admit them. He dominated Ethel. And nobody knew what he'd got hidden in the garden.